welcome back to our Back to One and All. During Act 1, we saw the back of 13 Prime Ministers, 14 to go. Now, if you left the auditorium at interval to have a pee or to buy some Shortis and Simpson merchandise, it can be likened to the length of time served by Francis Michael Ford as Australia's 14th Prime Minister.
Ladies and gentlemen, I deem it quite an honour.
The only one to play the violin. Click, click, so quick. Snap, snap, thunderclap. Done for, toasted, then roasted. Strutting rooster, soon a feather duster. Artie, he gets blown away in a southerly buster. Gone! Helping leaders of the twig. That's our calling, that's our gig. If you want leaders, here and gone, where? To call
Happy anniversary 2013, Roberta Quinn.
Happy anniversary 2013, John Henry Strong. March 11, 1996, and elections in the offing.
Howard Creams Keating, yay!
But a week before going on dusk, me and my pals, you and yours, in we sneak, climb the climb, and here...
In this rose garden,
I be wed.
Joint was overgrown back then, eh? A locked up, derelict ruin.
Change. Now, come back from the dead.
Every rose and their patrons, now named.
One over here's called Many Happy Returns.
This one's called Dearest.
This one's Sheer Bliss.
You are my dearest.
Sheer bliss was it to marry you.
Aren't we sounding wet?
Wet's good. Listen.
For what?
For a hint of what went on when we took each other to have and hold.
We knew your parents would be against it.
Gave them no chance to object.
They still think you married below yourself.
I still think, fuck them. We Germans.
And us Irish.
No for my folks.
Mind you, my mum and dad weren't then. They aren't now. An advertisement for getting married. A dysfunctional relationship.
Well, ours isn't. Marriage is the maddest, but best...
Wildest, but sanest thing
we two ever did. Come closer.
Will if you will.
Sp- spooky, this back too.
Weird. I'm seeing your mob of rowdies snaking in from that direction, going, Howard, yes, pushing you forward.
Wore the T-shirts with the little Johnny Howard cartoon to the front.
My maids of honour, male and female, were propped up, but also T-shirted, were chanting, Keating, yes.
Both sides stage a mock war, and we end up together.
Sassina's between us.
Do you remember what Sassina said?
Are you asking because you forget?
No, because her I'll always remember. This dusk.
In this rose garden, behold, brethren, for we bear witness.
Not just to a young couple exchanging vows.
But to them agreeing not to let their political differences mar their married life.
We've stuck to that.
Have done. You want to know something about our garden?
Mm?
They say that after dark it's home to a chain-smoking ghost, because it's here that a sleepless John Curtin paced from midnight to dawn when the war against Japan was looking oh so touch and go. You hungry?
Famished.
Could be after we eat. We get lucky.
Grew up down in Paddy's town in Brunswick, in an Irish Catholic sort of way. Born to be Prime Minister, his mother said. But that's what mothers say. Lura, 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 lay, lura, lay.
Size 8 R.M. William boots and his Hugo Boss tie.
Items he wore day of the apology speech.
Donated to the Museum of Australian Democracy, because Moad's got to be about the nation's politicians. But it's also got to be about the voters that make democracy tick. That's why, in the mix, our T-shirts stack up. They too will end up in a glass cabinet. That's what I get. Right in his way, you and me in ours. Who isn't parliamentary ephemera?
Could be. That's why I married you. You make me think. Twice.
Later.
We're in this dark circular display area at MOAD, an installation sort of space, and...
Happy Canberra Families is the theme, with Quinny and me clocking the Joseph Aloysius Lyons story. View him, wife Enid, and their children, on the lawn at the lodge.
It's here that the Strahls Go to Canberra 2013 gets to be a movie I want out of.
Says,
the family weren't always together. It was the height of the Depression, and Lyons, as Prime Minister, chose to travel the countryside, hoping to learn how people were coping.
And the commentary says, every night, wherever he was, Joe Lyons would write a letter to his beloved wife, Enid. And my wife beside me is weeping, and we're both crying in the dark. And in that booth, I'm wishing there was a letter I could write to make things better for you. I'm writing to you, Enid, to you, my dearest girl. As I travel through the real, real world. Dear girl, I've seen such suffering. Dear girl, I've seen such pain, the likes of which I hope I'll never see again. I've seen families on the breadline, kiddies on the street. They're desperate, begging for some scraps to eat.
Girl, I hope that in these hard times, when finding hope is hard, that we may be as strengthened as we're scarred. Girl, I look out of my window at the town we're passing through. All I see there is the ration queue, and it's hands out for a pittance, and hands out in the air, and in the pockets for the coins that are not there. And every footstep and every stranded man makes me determined to do what I can. Girl, I hope that in these hard times, when finding hope is hard, that we may be as strengthened as we're scarred. So many far from home, through no fault of their own. Oh, help me find an answer, so I'll need no more to roam. From all over this wide country, wherever I may go, your same old loving husband, Joe.
Pre the crash and pre the unprecedented probs, pre the ration queuing and the lack of jobs, there was a scholar of note. For 6 long years he kept the Aussie ship of state afloat.
Myself I'll introduce, I'm Stanley Melvin Bruce. Oh, how you bade good luck to me. Instead of Billy Hughes, I'll wear the PM's shoes. And now I'm afraid you're stuck with me. I don't care much for the common touch. Talk of depression keeps depressing me. I have no time for the picket line. I prefer the hub of the Melbourne Club to the calls of my constituency. My electro jets are with men in spats of British links. I'll speak superlatives. I am remote from the common bloke. No excuse, I'm Spruce Stanley Bruce, another useless conservative. I offer you sanity, safety, stability from my position of upward nobility. Be reassured, I strike no chord. No excuse, I'm Spruce Stanley Bruce, another useless conservative. Pompous is the word they call me. Lofty, high and mighty,
that's what they delight at.
Soon I'll be his royal Stanliness.
But me, I call him S. We married in
While
the age of very young. I am up before the sun, down the pits, then home in time to catch the moon. Every week just slips away without the light of day, till 1 o'clock on Saturday afternoon.
At the age of tender years, my youth it disappears down the pits, but the pittance that I earn helps to save the family's day and to keep the wolves at bay and to fuel the flame that will forever burn.
There's a better life to lead, so each day I choose to read in my lunch break by a pit lamp down the mine. Strive for better rights for all, join the union is the call, to keep the head above the poverty line.
You'll find me at the co-op store, beyond the library door, where I educate myself each night till 10. And the strikes are long and bitter, though the miner is the fitter, and the owner is the richer in the end.
My every ounce of flesh, my every drop of sweat you'll see, my every spot of blood, that's what you'll always get from me. At the coal face, at the coal face. Then comes the day I'm sailing to this sweet southern land, to fight the workers' cause as a labor man. And the memory that is foremost in my mind is the time I spent as a pit boy down the mine. Then comes the time I disagree with labor's solidarity, and I'm crossing to the right side of the floor.
As the time it slips away, I get more radical each day. A hardline man, I'm labor to the core.
Now I'm facing up to Fisher,
and I face up to Cook,
though we once read from the very same book. Is the time since we were both pit boys down the mine. My every ounce of flesh, my every drop of sweat you'll see, my every spot of blood, that's what you'll always get from me. At the coal face, at the coal face, at the coal face.
Rotund, pigeon-toed, always sucking sweets at a squeaky high-pitched voice, a great walrus moustache, fell asleep all the time, wore a monocle, and was a cartoonist's dream.
Georgie Reader, how you blab and babble?
A lunatic,
says old Sir Henry Fox. In every small cartoon, you're a clown, profound buffoon. A roly-poly dog who can be bought in Wally Box. Oh, you wouldn't read about it, Mr. Reader, except inside a comic book or a parliamentary street.
In all of your addresses, your excesses you'll exceed.
Oh, you wouldn't read about it, Mr. Reader.
Oi, Georgie, what are you going to call that baby in your stomach?
Well, if it's a boy, I'll call it after myself. If it's a girl, I'll call it Victoria after the Queen. But if, as I strongly suspect, it's nothing but piss and wind, then I'll name it after you.
Oh, you wouldn't read about it, Mr. Reader. Except it's like a comic book or a parliamentary screed.
In all of your addresses, your excesses, you'll exceed.
Charge all your glasses and let's make a toast to the little one, Johann Christian Tank. Born in a boat off the Chilean coast, the tiny one, Johann Christian Tank. His mother, a Kiwi, she's fine doing well in Valparaiso, Valparaiso. His father, a German, with stories to tell in Valparaiso, Valparaiso. From Valparaiso, they'll sail when they say so to the safe harbor of Guam. From Valparaiso, they'll sail when they say so, when troubled waters are calm. But the waters are stormy, unsettled and rough, Johann and his mother they head. To the south of New Zealand and life it was tough, till a Mr. George Watson she wed. Then in North Otago they settled at last, their lives they were never the same. They'll look to the future, not dwell on the past, and the young boy will take a new name. John Christian Watson, adventure he's got some, sense of it deep in his bones. So far away so, from Valparaiso to Sydney the young man will roam. So charge all your glasses and let's make a toast to political Johann Christian Tank. Born in a boat off the Chilean coast, Prime Minister Johann Christian Tank. Tank, 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 tank. Chris Watson, to you. Ha!
Put the skates on, we're heading home and you're driving.
I'm driving your car?
I've got some reading to do. A transcript of an oral history Janice gave me. Thought I might be interested.
Back there, while you were with Janice, I had this kind of flashback thingy. There was this touch screen about Chris Watson, Australia's third Prime Minister and the first ever national Labour leader in the world to win office. Anyway, this screen sees me entering a sort of a time-stood-still zone. A little kid inside me is back in Natamuck Primary. Kids paying out on me because I'm third generation German and so still, in Horsham, a wog. Then there's a string of aunts and uncles behind me coming down an aisle. Both sides of the family, the Strahls and the Kurzweils, in the pews of a Lutheran church, our mob, my mob. Then the grandparents give me a hard time. Was machst du? Sprechen Sie Deutsch? Sprechen Sie Deutsch? Anyway, the long and the short of it is, John, Chris for Christian Watson, Australia's third Prime Minister, was actually born Johann Christian Tank. Had a Chilean-German father. Was thus of German descent.
Like you.
Like me. And if I'd have been taught that, I could have given those yobs back at school as good as I got.
Sorry?
Oh, forget it. We click through the kilometres, me waiting, while she reading, flips through the pages of this story she's so deeply into, feeding me dribs. Drib one is...
There's this bloke, ex-army, lands a gig as a rigger with the Snowy Mountain Authority. It's a love story.
Drib two is...
A young woman from Slovenia, made stateless by the war after a spell in Bonegilla, gets employed as a kitchen hand at a Snowy Mountains camp in Cooma. They hook up.
Drip three.
Married now, they gravitate to Canberra. She ends up running the parliamentary member's dining room, and he gets a billet in security at what is now Old Parliament House. They occupy the caretaker's flat, it goes with the job. But sadly, they are childless.
Like?
Us. As a result, they foster children.
And?
And here I am on page 66. Janice highlighted it for me. In 1976, we had the two Roberts staying with us. Not just little Robert Tonkin, but little Roberta Quinn.
What are you saying?
I'm saying that when in Bathurst, my parents are trying to slaughter each other, and I'm taken into the care of this couple.
Bullshit.
For 3 months, as a 3-going-on-4-year-old, I lived...
at Old Parliament House. I swerve.
What the fuck?
Wombat.
In one blow, two of my life's great mysteries solved. It's always haunted me. A memory of me first learning how to roller skate. But where? Answers here in black and white. In the basement of Old Parliament House. Little Robert Tonkin lent me the skates and taught me the art.
The other mystery?
Why, in 1996, I so wanted us to get married in the Rose Garden. We even broke in to do so.
For a lark. Seemed like a good idea at the time.
Repressed memory syndrome. You heard of it? Janice has. And I now think it's because I played in that garden as a kid.
And then she's asleep. Out from Minyip, way later, the most incredible sunset seems to wake her.
Who said you could drive my car?
You did. We stop the car. Get out. Swap seats.
Ladies and gentlemen, take your partners for the affable Alfred. Why, thank you.
The affable Alfred, Alfred Deacon, lovable when you hear him speaking countless words a minute he can express.
The quotable, notable Alfred Deacon, audible, laudable, shining beacon, eloquently he knows how to impress.
But the writer, the dreamer, the inner man, he digs as deep as he thinks he can to find he feels more insecure, morose.
While the multi-syllable, always speaking multi-syllable, Alfred Deacon's never short of words, and never verbose.
Very good. Very nice.
Affable Alf.
After you.
Oh, no, sir, I insist.
Why, thank you.
The most unshakable, never weak and unmistakable, Alfred Deacon furthers his political career.
The patient legislation seeking ethereal, prime ministerial Deacon can persuade a mind and bend an ear.
But the theatre-goer, the journalist, the poet, the author, the spiritualist, he's questioning the darker soul within.
While the unbendable, arbitration-seeking, dependable Mr. Alfred Deacon picks himself a fight, he's dying to win.
Australian Parliament, we have practically three equal parties, and the position is unstable. What sort of a game of cricket could our cricketers play if there were three 11s instead of two? One side playing sometimes for one team, sometimes for the other, and sometimes for itself. It is absolutely essential that the three parties be dissolved into two. Someone must give way for the benefit of the state. And which is to give way is the delicate issue. Reed? Watson? Anyone but...
Aff-
laughable Alf.
He's our first prime minister, the one who so vigorously shall have been granted to or acquired by the Commonwealth, and shall be vested in, and belong to the Commonwealth.